Hello learners, I welcome you to this session. I am Mohini Arora and we'll be discussing about functions, which is for the students of computer science course. So let's begin the session. I hope you will learn from it and it will be a gaining experience for you. So in this session, we'll be first talking about the main function. You have programmed in main function before also. So, we will be just giving a revision course on main function. Then, we will be talking about built-in functions. So, in functions, we will be discussing about the objectives that we will be covering in this session are, we will be defining functions that are included in maths.h, ctype.h and string.h header files, explaining IO console functions, learn about user defined functions. We'll be talking about function prototype, definition and function call. We'll learn the two methods of passing arguments, local and global variables. So let's begin covering these topics one by one. First, we talk about main function. Till now, you have formed programs using main functions. So main function has to be there in all C++ programs. And main function is the one from where the program execution starts. So it's an essential function in all C++ programs. If there is a single function in a program, it has to be a main function. If there are multiple functions, one of them will be a main function. But if there is a single function, then it has to be the main function only. The main function is the starting point for the execution of the program. And the definition you can see on the screen, main function. By default, it returns an integer value. So, you have to give return 0 or any integer as the last statement of the main function. If you don't want the main function to return anything, then you say void main function. In that case, you need not give the return statement. So, by default, as the slide also says, the main function returns the value of integer to the operating system. Functions are a set of code that can be reused again and again. So, those functions which are defined in some or the other header files are known as library functions. So, in this session, we will be talking about three header files, math.h, ctype.h and string.h. So, some of the functions which are covered, which are defined in these header files, we'll be discussing those functions and these header files as well. So, C++ provides many built-in functions that save the programming time, mathematical functions, character functions, string functions and console input-output functions. Let's do them one by one. So, the slide here shows the mathematical functions from math.h. You can see on the slide, it's saying sin x, which gives sine of an angle x, cos x, which gives cosine of an angle x, tan, a sine, a cos, these give you the reverse of sine and cos, exponential function, which gives the exponent of a particular number x. Then you also have functions which give you the logarithm to the base 10, square root, power, absolute value of an integer number or absolute value of a real number. So, using these functions according to the syntax will give you the required output. All these are related to mathematical operations that you can perform on the given input data that you want to process. All these functions are defined in the header file math.h. Next, we move on to character functions defined in ctype.h. A character is any character, any key that you key in on the keyboard is capable of being a character. A number can also be a character, an alphabet is a character, an uppercase alphabet is a character, a lowercase alphabet is a character. You have symbols on the keyboard, they are also characters. You have keys like spacebar, like enter, they are also characters. So, the functions which work on these character variables or character constants are character functions. These functions are defined in header file ctype.h and here we are covering some of them. You can see on your slide, is alpha. It returns true if the character being passed is an alphabet and false otherwise. is digit checks for the digit, whether it is a character lying between 0 and 9, then it returns a true. Is alnum returns a true if it is either an alphabet or a number. If it is a special character or a white space character, it returns a false. Then is lower checks for a lowercase alphabet, is upper checks for an uppercase alphabet. To upper converts a lowercase character to uppercase. If the character is not a lowercase alphabet, anything else other than that, then it returns that as it is without any change. Similarly, to upper converts a converts a uppercase alphabet to lowercase. If the character being passed as input or as an argument is not a lowercase alphabet, then it returns it as it is. Next, we move on to string.h or string functions. A string is a set of characters, multiple characters, and every string is terminated by a null character. So, these are the functions that you see on your slide which work on strings, and these are defined in string.h. So, you have strlen function which returns the length of the string, that means the number of characters that a string has minus the null character. Then strcat which concatenates first string after another. Here concatenation means adding first string after the second one. strcpy, string copy, which copies one string onto the another. The previous string is totally removed, overwritten by the new string. Then strcmp, string comparison. It returns a 0 if both the strings being compared are same, otherwise it returns a true. And here I must tell you that this function is case sensitive. That means if a string is in capital letters, another string is in small letters, still for strcmp they are unequal strings. Next we move on to console input output functions which are defined in stdio.h. When I talk about console, I talk about standard input output functions. Standard input device is the keyboard and standard output device is the monitor. So, the functions which are related to getting input from the keyboard and giving output to the monitor are console input output functions, and these are defined in the header file stdio.h. The functions that we will be covering today are getCar function, putCar function, getS function and putS function. GetCar function is used to accept a single character from the user. Whatever the user enters, that is stored in a character variable. As you can see on your screen, it returns a single character from a standard input device, that is the keyboard. It does not take any parameter. In fact, whatever the user enters is stored in a particular variable. In the syntax that is given here, A is a character variable and it stores any single character that is keyed in through the keyboard. Then next we have putCar function. It is used to display a character on the standard output device, that is the monitor. As you can see on the screen, the syntax for putCar is it takes the character variable as the argument. And whatever character variable is being passed, that is displayed on the monitor. So, in the example that you see, ch is the character variable, played the value of ch will be displayed on the monitor. Next we have get s. Here s is string. So, this function is get string. It is used to accept multiple characters from the user. It is so when you were accepting a single character, you were using getCar function. Now you want to accept multiple characters, you want to accept a string, so you are using the getS function. This getS function is used to get the multiple characters from the user, and these multiple characters may include white spaces, may include new lines, may include any character, number, alphabet, symbols from the keyboard. So, it gets a string terminated by a new line character. That means the moment you press enter key, the whatever data the user has entered, that is stored in the variable name that is being passed as argument to getS. You can see on your screen the syntax is given as getS A. So whatever the user enters through the keyboard, till the time he doesn't press the enter key, he can enter the data. The moment he presses the enter key, then whatever data he has entered is stored in A. And the moment the enter key is pressed, the string is terminated by a null character. So this is about getS. Next we move on to putS. putS is used to display data on the monitor, display multiple characters or strings on the monitor. It is equivalent to cout, and it can also display characters including white spaces and new lines. Next we talk about getch and getche function. Getch and getche, both these functions are used to accept characters from the user. The difference here lies is that getch, whatever you enter through the keyboard, that particular character is not displayed on the screen, whereas getche, where e stands for echo. So whatever character is entered, it is displayed on the screen. So that is the difference between getch and getche. Both these functions are used to accept a single character from the user. So you can see that in your screen also, there are two variables, ch, which is taking the value from getche, and ch1, which is taking the value from getch. And both these functions are defined in the header file conio.h. As the cursor blinks, you type the character. Getche will echo the character and getch will not echo the character. So these are the built-in functions or library functions defined in various header files, and as per your requirement you include that particular header file. So that means if you want to use a function that is defined in ctype.h, then that particular header file has to be included in your program, otherwise your system will flash an error. Now we move on to user defined functions. Till now you have been using the functions that have been defined in some or the other header file. Now you will be defining your own functions and using them. That is why the name user defined functions. A C++ function is the grouping of program statements in a single unit. A function may or may not have a header file because function is a part of a program. So already your iostream.h is there, your main function is there. So you may not require a separate header file just for a particular function. Till the time you are not using any statement, any C++ executable statement which requires a header file. A function may have a return value, may not have a return value. A function which does not have a return value are known as void functions, and a function which return a particular value should use the data type of that particular value in the function header. So next we talk about function prototype. You have declared variables in the previous program. So function prototype is declaration of functions in a program. It is information to the compiler that there is a function by so and so name which will return so and so value and pass so and so argument. You must give the function prototype if you are trying to use the function before defining it. That means you are trying to call the function before defining it. But if the function definition is given before the function call, you might skip out with the prototype. And every function prototype must end with a semicolon, in the same manner as every variable declaration used to end with a semicolon. Similarly, every function prototype must also end with a semicolon. So in your screen you have the examples of function prototype. You have the sum function, which is a void function, that is why the prototype is void sum function. Next function is a test function which is returning an integer value. So the data type int is given before the test function. Then you have the result function which is taking two arguments, one integer, one character, and it is returning an integer also. So you must see that all these function prototypes are ending with a semicolon, and we are specifying very clearly the name, the data type of the arguments and the data type of the return value that the function is returning. So, this is about function prototype. Then we talk about arguments or parameters that are given to the function. A function may require some input values to do the processing that it is intended to do. So, the input values that we give to a function are known as arguments or parameters of a function. As you can see on your screen also, sometimes the calling function supplies some values to the called function. So, if I am in the main function and I am trying to call test function, then some values might be required by the test function. So, the main function becomes the calling function and test function becomes the called function. So, the variables which supply the values to the function are known as actual parameters. That means, if I enter a number A and the user enters 10, so that value that is being given to the function being called is the actual parameter. And inside the function, the value that is taken by a variable, the value 10 that is received by the variable to perform the processing are formal parameters. So, the screen also talks about the variables which supply the values to the calling function are called actual parameters, and the variables which receive the value when the function call statement is given are termed as formal parameters. See, in the example, you can see that in the main function, radius is the actual parameter because it is receiving the value, and then formal parameter is R, which is given in the definition of area. So, that is the formal parameter. And you can see the prototype also given in the second statement, which is ending with a semicolon. And you must have noticed that the number of arguments in the function prototype, number and type of arguments in the function prototype, number and type of arguments in the function call, and function definition are all same. Only then we are referring to one single function. If you change any of these, then we are not referring to one single function. Similarly, we talk about return types. You can see in the example given that in the main function, there is a variable y which is receiving the value of area. So, function call statement, you can see that the variable y is capturing the value being returned by area. And in the area function, you can see that a value 3.14 into R, that means the area of a circle, is being returned. So, whenever you call this function area, it will return the calculated area, and that calculated area will be stored in Y. So, the example here shows that return statement begins with the keyword return, and then the value is returned. The value being returned should have the same data type as specified in the function header. As you can see in the example also, the function header is float area and the value being returned is also a float type, and y, which is capturing the value in the example, is also a float variable. So, you have to be careful that the return type, the data type that you are specifying as the return type, should be same in function prototype, function definition, and function call as well. Next, we talk about local and global variables. Till now, you have been working with the main function. You have created variables inside the main function. You have processed them, displayed the output, and you have executed the program. Now, you will be working with multiple functions in the same program. You will declare multiple variables, some inside a particular function, some outside. So, a local variable is that which is declared or defined inside a particular function. You can see on your slide the definition. A variable declared within the body of a function will be evaluated only within that function. Within the set of curly brackets, whatever variable is declared, it can be used inside that set of curly brackets only. So, the portion of the program in which a variable is retained or in which a variable can be accessed is called the scope of the variable. A variable may be local to a function or even to a compound statement. Compound statement, for example, I might declare a variable inside a loop. Then that particular variable is local to that particular loop only. I cannot access it outside the loop. So, these are what the local variables. Next, we move on to global variables. A global variable does not belong to any one function or a compound statement. It is declared outside all functions. So, it is accessible by all functions that follow that particular declaration. So, you can see on your slide, a variable that is declared outside any function is a global variable. The scope of such variable is the entire program, and these variables are available to all functions which follow their declaration. Any variable when declared globally is available to all functions, all statements after it. Before it, it is not available. It might be a global variable, but then before it, it is not available. And if you declare two variables by the same name, one local variable, one global variable, then to differentiate them, you will use a scope resolution operator, which is a set of two colons. In front of a global variable name, you will use a scope resolution operator. You can see the example on your slide. There is a global variable M declared in the second statement on the slide, and there is a local variable M inside the main function. Then below that, you can see that to access the global variable, in front of M, I am using scope resolution operator. That means I am displaying 2 at this particular place. Whereas, wherever I am accessing M without the scope resolution operator, at that particular place, 15 will be displayed. So, that is how we differentiate a local and a global variable with or without the scope resolution operator. In case I am declaring both the variables with the same name. So, that is about global and local variables. And then we talk about the variables and different types of storage that a variable can have. You can have an automatic variable, a register variable, a static variable, or an external variable. Till now, you have been working with automatic variables. They are by default. That means if you declare int x or you declare auto int x, they are just the same. All variables are by default automatic variables. According to their data type, they are allocated memory. On your screen, you can see that all variables are by default auto. They retain their scope till the end of the function in which they are declared. That means if an auto variable is made local, it will be accessed in that particular function. If it is declared as global, then it can be accessed across all the functions. The variables are automatically created when a function is called and automatically destroyed when it returns. This is about local variables. As soon as the function closes, their scope also ends. Then we talk about an example of automatic variables. A variable I is declared, which is an auto variable, and inside the sum function, a variable s is declared, which is also an auto function, and s is accessible only inside the sum function, I is accessible only inside the main function. So, I is local to main and s is local to sum. Then register variable, it is just same as the auto variable. The difference is it is stored in CPU registers. So, the access is faster as compared to the normal auto variables. So, it has all the characteristics of an auto variable, but it provides fast access as they are stored inside the CPU registers rather than in memory, and they can be applied to both local and global variables. Moving on to static variables. A static variable is one which retains its value even though the function call is over. As you can see on your screen, a static variable has the visibility of a local variable, but the lifetime of an external variable. That means, although I cannot access the variable, but the value that it has will be retained. It will not be lost. That means, if I access the function again, I can see the same value in my variable. To declare a static variable, you just precede it with the keyword static and it becomes a static variable. As you can see on your screen, the syntax, static int s is equals to 0. So now even though after the function scope is over, I cannot access s, but the value of s will remain as it is. That is what is a static variable. Moving to external variable or external variable. This variable is used when I want to use a particular value or I want to access a particular variable across multiple files. I have a particular data in a particular C++ file. I want to access that very data through that very variable in some other file. So I create that variable as extern variable. The keyword is extern. And I declare it as extern so that I can use it in a particular file as external variable. So you can see here that a large program may be written by a number of people and they would like to share the data. So I can use the extern variable for that particular data. Then we talk about passing values, passing arguments to the function or calling a particular function. There are two ways: call by value and call by reference. Call by value, the value of actual parameter is passed on to the formal parameter. So actual parameter and formal parameter both are independent memory location. Any change in one will not be affected in another because they are independent memory locations. You can see on your screen, the value of actual parameter is passed on to the formal parameter and change is not affected across. That means any change that you make in actual parameter will not be affected by the formal parameter and vice versa. You can see in the example here, there are two variables A and B which are the actual parameters and there are two variables C and D which are formal parameters to the function swap. Both the values 5 and 6 are being passed from A and B to C and D respectively, and both are independent memory locations. So any change in C and D is not affected in A and B. So this is what is shown in the example also. Then we talk about call by reference. As we have learned before, reference is an alias, a new name given to an already existing variable. Here also, when I use call by reference, then I am just giving a new name to an already existing variable. That means I am referring to the same memory location. So any change made in the formal parameters will affect the actual parameters and vice versa. And I pass call by reference by using the ampersand symbol, as you can see in the example also. Here, same memory location A, B, C, D. That means A and C are referring to the same memory location and B and D are referring to the same memory location. So any change in A is reflected back in C and any change in B is reflected back in D. So the output, you see the swapping that is happening. So this is what is called by reference. So whenever you want the change to affect the actual parameters, you should use call by reference. If you want the change in the function not to be affected in actual parameters, then you use call by value. So with this, we come to the end of this session. So in this session, you have used functions defined in header file mat.h, ctype.h and string.h. You've learnt about IO console functions, input output console functions, that is getCar, putCar, getS and putS functions. Then you have learnt about user defined functions, how to give a function prototype, how to define a function and how to call a function. Thereafter we talked about local and global variables and two methods of passing arguments, that is call by value and call by reference. I hope this session proved to be a learning experience to you. You have gained knowledge about functions, and thank you so much.